The next item of business is consideration of business motion 2148 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out changes to this week's business. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now, and I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 2148 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions. In order to get in as many questions as possible, short and succinct questions and responses would be appreciated. And I call it question number one, Katie Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of reports of a legal opinion stating that local authorities cannot use their bylaw powers to implement buffer zones at NHS reproductive health facilities, how it will ensure that women have access to these services free of harassment.
Minister Marie Todd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Our programme for government includes a commitment to support any local authority who wishes to use bylaws to establish buffer zones. We are all agreed in the Scottish Parliament, and it seems in local government too, that it is absolutely unacceptable for any woman to face harassment when accessing healthcare. I'm not trying to shift the burden onto local authorities, but we don't share the view that bylaws cannot be used, and we'll work with them to explore every possible avenue to find a way forward. Ministers will look at bringing together key parties as soon as possible to discuss potential solutions. And in addition, the Scottish Government looks forward to the Members' Bill being proposed by Gillian Mackay, and I'm happy to discuss her proposals with her.
Katie Clark.
Does the Minister not accept, however, that it's the responsibility of the Scottish Government to ensure that women have safe access to NHS services? We know that 7 hospitals and clinics in Scotland have been repeatedly targeted. So will the Minister not agree, given that there does seem to be legal problems, but also we don't want a postcode lottery with some local authorities taking action and others not, will the Minister now consider Scottish-wide legislation to create buffered zones roundabout facilities?
Minister.
So the principle of protected spaces is one which this government absolutely supports, and that's why we have said that we would support local authority use of bylaws. In terms of taking forward how we progress on this issue, next week my officials are meeting with COSLA and with local authority representatives to find a way forward. I plan to also convene a ministerial working group, so I will be taking the lead to bring together interested parties, COSLA, health, police, to find a way forward urgently. I am absolutely determined to make progress on this. And I have been absolutely crystal clear. I don't disagree with Gillian Mackay on this issue. In many ways, I look forward to seeing the legislation that she brings forward. We'll look closely at the detail of that, but the principles, I think, we are largely agreed on.
Katie Clark.
But doesn't the Minister accept that really it would be far better if the Scottish Government brought forward legislation rather than relying on private members' bill or indeed local authorities to act in situations where they're being advised that they don't have legal competence?
Minister.
So one of the main reasons that we're keen to work with local authorities on this issue, and we don't share the view that bylaws cannot be used, one of the main reasons that we're keen to work with them on this issue is that we think that that's the fastest way to find a solution. Primary legislation will take time to pass through the course of this Parliament, and it will take time to enact. We think that using bylaws is a far speedier way to resolve the situation than any other solution. But to be absolutely clear, I am willing to work with local authorities, and I am willing to work with police, I am willing to work with health. I am determined to make progress on this issue.
Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Minister for her indication of working together on my member's bill. Given that primary legislation will take quite a while to come forward and there does seem to be a legal impasse between the Scottish Government and local authorities, has the Minister given any thought to what we could put in temporarily to make sure that women are not harassed when accessing these facilities?
Minister.
So certainly, as I said, as I outlined, what I'm keen to do is to find a way forward, and I would like speedy resolution to this situation. One of the reasons that I'm keen to use bylaws is I think it is the fastest way forward, but my officials are meeting with COSLA and some specific local authorities just next week. This will be one of the, finding a fast solution will be one of the main items on the agenda, and as I said, I'm keen to convene a ministerial group. I am keen to bring urgency to the resolution of this situation.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was very proud to speak alongside Gillian Mackay in her members' debate on this issue, and join members from all parties in our shared belief that somebody's right to freedom of speech does not trump somebody's right to medical privacy or the right to seek intimate medical care without molestation. But the Minister shattered that consensus that evening by saying the government were unmoved. If the Minister is determined that there is a difference of legal opinion here, the opinion received by SOLO was, I quote, unequivocal that bylaws could not be used to create buffer zones by local authorities. If the government, can I ask the Minister if her government has sought legal opinion to the contrary? And if so, will she publish it?
Minister.
So I don't think I need to rehearse again the principles of legal opinion and publishing legal opinion. The principle of protected spaces is one which this government supports. And that is why we have said that we would support any local authority who wish to bring forward bylaws to ensure that women had protected spaces and were not harassed as they accessed healthcare. Let me be absolutely clear, we are committed on that principle and I am absolutely committed to finding a way forward.
Thank you. Question number two, Jamie Green.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government which victim support organisations it consulted with ahead of drafting the paper consultation on bail and release from custody arrangements in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
In developing proposals for formal consultation, the Scottish Government discussed these issues informally with a range of partners, including the Victims Organisation Collaboration Forum Scotland, chaired by Victim Support Scotland. Public protection and victim safety are at the heart of the proposals for reform, which are focused on reducing crime, reoffending and future victimisation. Building on engagement with victims' organisations throughout the pandemic, we will continue to work closely with them and with a range of other partners during the consultation and bill processes to ensure their views are heard and inform future decisions in this critical area, and by refocusing use of custody so it is for those that pose a particular risk to public safety. I want to help deliver further improvements to the safety of the people of Scotland. Recorded crime remains at one of its lowest levels since 1974 and is down 41% since 2006-07. I want to build further on these achievements by ensuring custody, including the use of remand, is used appropriately and enhanced support is provided for those dealt with in the community for their offending behaviour.
Jamie Green.
Thank you. The consultation includes a proposal to shorten the automatic early release trigger for criminals from having served half of their sentence to just a third. But we know that 30% of prisoners who receive a sentence of less than 4 years go on to reoffend, compared to just 8% of those sentenced to 4 years or more. The evidence is clear, Presiding Officer. The shorter the sentence, the higher the reoffending rate, which undoubtedly further traumatises victims of crime and does nothing to solve the problem of either overcrowding in our prisons or reoffending, for that matter. Can I ask, what message of fairness and justice does the Cabinet Secretary think that releasing criminals a third of the way through their sentence will send to the victims of those crimes?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, the proposals which Jamie Green refers to are one or two proposals amongst a whole list of proposals which seek to address a number of concerns, not least concerns which he has raised in relation, for example, to the high remand population. It's always true that the discretion in these areas lies with the courts, and the courts can take into account the issues which Jamie Green has mentioned when they pass sentence. So these things are dealt with by the courts. That's the way it should be. And what we want to have is a genuine discussion based on the almost consensual concerns which have been expressed across the Parliament. And it's also true to say that if we can, of course, reduce further the prison population, then the amount of time and effort that can be spent on individual prisoners is greater, and thereby reducing even further the recidivism rate. So the continuation of our policies, which have led to some of the lowest crime records ever, have led to the lowest number of recorded homicides ever, are consistent with these proposals. But, of course, we'll wait to see what people come back with.
Jamie Green.
It's interesting the Cabinet Secretary did not address the issue of reoffending, which I presume forms part of the consultation in the first place. But I'm afraid week after week we come to this chamber and we hear countless proposals of how we're going to water down sentencing guidelines, whether it's how we treat criminals under 25, automatic release triggers, and now the prospect of giving ministers the power to release prisoners simply out of fear of our prisons becoming full. I'm afraid this is a move which reeks of a panic-stricken government facing down the barrel of a court backlog of tens of thousands of cases yet to be heard. Now, we've just heard again, and we are frequently reminded in this chamber by the Cabinet Secretary, that decisions about remand and sentencing are rightly made by independent judges. So why does he now think that ministers know better than they do?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member says he presumes something is in the consultation. I would have hoped he'd have read the consultation before he actually... Well, he presumes it's in the consultation, so obviously he doesn't know. So he should really read these things before he comes to ask these questions. And it is the case that discretion will remain with the court. That's the way that we do things in this country. The independent courts decide on these things. But it's also true to say that remand is at a very high level in Scotland. And he's right to say, of course, there's a concern about the number of the backlog of cases. It's not peculiar to this jurisdiction that we have a backlog of cases due to the pandemic. And also, in relation to the point about, which I think he referred to, of automatic early release, of course, it was the Conservatives that brought in automatic early release, and they were the ones that voted against it the last time this Parliament voted on it. So I don't know where the Tories are on justice these days. I don't think they've got a clue what is meant by soft justice anymore. What we want to have is smart, effective justice and make sure the right people are in prison and people are given the rehabilitation opportunities that they should have to make sure that we continue to drive down the levels of recidivism, which we are doing successfully.
Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the launch of the consultation and acknowledge that this is something that has formed a core part of the discussion within the Criminal Justice Committee this session. Indeed, the need to prevent indefinite imprisonment via remand is something that has been mentioned on several occasions. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to expand on how this consultation will look to tackle the issues of prison population and remand?
Well, the member asked an important question, which has already been alluded to, of course, by Jamie Green. And the Parliament has been clear in recent years that too many people are being held on remand. I think that's shared across all the parties. And it's right, as I've said, that courts make such decisions based on the individual cases before them. But this consultation looks afresh at the legal framework within which these decisions are made. I would say that if people don't accept that, then perhaps they can offer an alternative way forward. But I thought that was where the Parliament wanted to concentrate its activities. We want remand to only be used where it's absolutely necessary. And the proposals emphasise the importance of public safety and victim safety being at the forefront of decisions whether to remand. Where an accused person does not pose a significant risk but does require additional support or supervision in the community, such as drug treatment, then bail should be the default option with necessary enhanced support given. And I'm grateful for the Criminal Justice Committees, of which the member is a convener, their early focus on this area, and I look forward to working with members during the consultation and bill process. I appreciated the opportunity to have an early discussion about this when I attended the committee back in September, and I welcomed at that point Jamie Green's comments that there are human rights aspects to this matter, particularly in relation to the length of time people are held on remand. Remand, just to remind members, is now at 30% of the prison population. That is too high. And I urge those with an interest to respond to the proposals for reform.
Pauline McNeill.
The Cabinet Secretary is aware that there was a significant rise in remand in Scotland, with the population almost doubling between April 2020 and April this year. And by the end of that period, close to one in four prisoners were on remand, but worryingly 40% aged 16 to 20 on remand. Some evidence suggests that requests for supervised bail orders have been historically low, with a possible factor being a lack of awareness of available programmes and a scarcity of short-term funding. So given the consultation on bail and release from custody has only just begun, And we perhaps need a kind of short to medium term answer to this. As the Cabinet Secretary, would the government make the judiciary more aware of supervised bail orders as an immediate or medium term step so that we can start to bring down the high levels of remand Scotland sooner rather than later?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can't speak, obviously, for the judiciary, as the member knows, but it is true to say the judiciary are aware of the alternatives that they have. I think we sometimes have to make sure that people have confidence in those alternatives. I think the other point to make is, in relation to remand, we should also be looking, and I would hope the consultation would shed some light on this, at what we can do to protect victims of those that are accused who then go on remand as well. So I think we have some more work to do in relation to that. But the member has raised before the very high levels of remand. That is what we intend to try and address in relation to this. And I would just repeat the point, and I'm grateful for the comments the members made in the past in relation to this, that if others have different ideas about how to address the situation, which you all seem to agree on has to be addressed, then they can come forward with those proposals and we will listen to them.